test. Shabbat shalom, everyone. Welcome to our service today. What a week, huh? Amen. If everybody would rise, we are going to welcome Yehuda ben Shalom to blow the shofar for us today. Baruch atah Adonai Eloheinu melech ha'olam, asher kachanu b'mitzvotav v'tzivanu l'shmo kol shofar. For English, blessed are you, Lord our God, King of the universe, who has sanctified us with his commandments and commanded us to hear the voice of the shofar. Please join us as we sing the Mantovu.
Mantovu, ohalecha Yaakov, miskenotecha Yisrael, vani berochas deja avon beiteja eistachave eileja kasheja beirateja.
The soul of every living being shall bless your name, Hashem our God. The spirit of all flesh shall always glorify and exalt your remembrance, our King. From this world to the world to come, you are God. And other than you, we have no King, Redeemer, or Savior. Liberator, Rescuer, Sustainer, and Merciful One in every time of distress and anguish, we have no King but you. God of the first and God of the last, God of all creatures, master of all generations, who is extolled through a multitude of praises, who guides his world with kindness and his creatures with mercy. Hashem neither slumbers nor sleeps. He who rouses the sleepers and awakens the slumberers, who makes the mute speak and releases the bound, who supports the fallen and straightens the bent, to you alone we give thanks. Were our mouth as full of song as the sea, and our tongue as full of joyous song as its multitudes of waves, and our lips as full of praise as the breath of the heavens, and our eyes as brilliant as the sun and the moon, and our hands as outspread as eagles of the sky, and our feet as swift as hinds, we still could not thank you sufficiently, Hashem, our God, and the God of our forefathers, and to bless your name for even one of the thousands of thousands and myriads of favors that you performed for our ancestors and for us. You redeemed us from Mitzrayim, Hashem, our God, and you liberated us from the house of bondage. In famine, you nourished us, and in plenty, you sustained us. From sword, you saved us. From plague, you let us escape. And from severe and enduring diseases, you spared us. Until now, your mercy has helped us, and your kindness has not forsaken us. Do not abandon us, Hashem, our God, forever. Therefore, the organs that you set within us, and the spirit and the soul that you breathed into our nostrils, and the tongue that you placed in our mouth, all of them shall thank and bless, praise and glorify, exalt and revere, sanctify and declare the sovereignty of your name, our King. For every mouth shall offer thanks to you, every tongue shall vow allegiance to you, every knee shall bend to you, every erect spine shall prostrate itself before you. All hearts shall fear you, and all innermost feelings and thoughts shall sing praises to your name. As it is written, all my bones shall say, Hashem, who is like you? You save the poor man from one stronger than he, the poor and the destitute from one who would rob him. Who is like unto you? Who is equal to you? Who can be compared to you? O great, mighty, and awesome God, the supreme God, creator of heaven and earth.
Nehalelcha unesabechacha unefarecha unevarech et shem kadechecha kamur le David barhi nabshi et Adonai bekol kravi et shem kadsho.
Amen. May your name be praised forever, our King, the God, the great and holy King, in heaven and on earth, because for you it is fitting, O Hashem, our God, and the God of our forefathers, song and praise, lauding and hymns, power and dominion, triumph, greatness and strength, praise and splendor, holiness and sovereignty, blessings and thanksgivings from this time and forever.
Baruch atah Adonai, el melech gadol batizbachot, el ha'odaot, Adonai niflaot,
Amen.
Barhu et Adonai Amborach. Baruch Adonai Amborach Leolam Baed. Baruch Ata Adonai Eloheinu Melech Haolam. Yoser Oro Bori Hoshek. Ose Shalom Uborei Et Hakol. May sit, please.
To the God who rested from all works, who ascended on the seventh day and sat on the throne of his glory. With splendor he enwrapped the day of contentment. He declared the Shabbat day a delight. This is the praise of the Shabbat day, that on it God rested from all his work. And the seventh day gives praise, saying, a song for the Shabbat day. It is good to thank Hashem. Therefore, let all that he has fashioned glorify, bless God. Praise, honor, and greatness let them render to God, the King who fashioned everything, who gives a heritage of contentment to his people, Israel, in his holiness on the holy Shabbat day. May your name, Adonai, our God, be sanctified, and may your remembrance, our King, be glorified in the heaven above and upon the earth below. May you be blessed, our Savior, beyond the praises of your handiwork, and beyond the brilliant luminaries that you have made, may they glorify you, Selah. To the blessed God, they shall offer sweet melodies. To the King, the living and enduring God, they shall sing hymns and proclaim praises. For he alone effects mighty deeds. He makes new things. He is master of wars. He sows kindnesses. He makes salvation flourish. He creates cures. He is too awesome for praise. Is Lord of wonders. In his goodness, he renews daily, perpetually, the works of creation. As it is said, give thanks to him who makes the great luminaries, for his kindness endures forever.
Hor jadas al zion ta'im, benizke kulan omer aleoro, barujata donai, yotzea meoro.
Amen. With an abundant love have you loved us, Hashem our God. With exceedingly great pity have you pitied us, our Father, our King, for the sake of our forefathers who trusted in you and whom you who you taught the decrees of life. May you be equally gracious to us and teach us. Our Father, the merciful Father, who acts mercifully, have mercy upon us. Instill in our hearts to understand and elucidate, to listen, learn, teach, safeguard, perform, and fulfill all the words of your Torah's teachings with love. Enlighten our eyes in your Torah. Attach our hearts to your commandments. And unify our hearts to love and fear your name. And may we not feel inner shame for all eternity, because we have trusted in your great and awesome holy name. May we exalt and rejoice in your Yeshua. Bring us in peacefulness from the four corners of the earth and lead us with upright pride to our land. For you effect salvations, O Adonai. You have chosen us from among every people and tongue.
Aboher beamo Yisrael beava. Shema Yisrael Adonai Eloheinu Adonai Echad. Baruch Shem Kevo Malchuto Leolam Baed.
You shall love Adonai your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your resources. Let these matters that I command you today be upon your heart, and teach them thoroughly to your children, and speak of them while you sit in your home, while you walk on the way, when you retire, and when you arise. Bind them as a sign upon your arm, and let them be tefillin between your eyes, and write them on the doorposts of your house and upon your gates. And it will come to pass that if you continually hearken to my commandments that I command you today, to love Adonai your God, and to serve him with all your heart and with all your soul. Then I will provide rain for your land in its proper time, the early and late rains, that you may gather in your grain, your wine, and your oil. I will provide grass in your field for your cattle, and you will eat and be satisfied. Beware lest your heart be seduced, and you turn astray, and serve gods of others, and bow to them. Then the wrath of Elohim will blaze against you. He will restrain the heavens so there will be no rain, and the ground will not yield its produce. And you will swiftly be banished from the goodly land which Adonai gives you. Place these words of mine upon your heart and upon your soul. Bind them as a sign on your arm, and let them be tefillin between your eyes. Teach them to your children to discuss them while you sit in your home, while you walk on the way, when you retire and when you arise. And write them on the doorpost of your house and upon your gates. In order to prolong your days and the days of your children upon the ground that Adonai has sworn to your ancestors to give them, like the days of the heavens on the earth. And Hashem said to Moses, saying, speak to the children of Israel and say to them that they are to make themselves tzitzit on the corners of their garments throughout their generations. And they are to place upon the tzitzit of each corner a thread of tekelis, and it shall constitute tzitzit for you, that you may see it and remember all the commandments of Hashem and perform them, and not explore after your heart and after your eyes after which you stray, so that you may remember and perform all my commandments and be holy to your God. I am Adonai your God, who has removed you from the land of Mizraim to be a God to you. I am Adonai your God, it is true.
Adonai Elohei Hanemet.
Amen. And certain, established and enduring, fair and faithful, beloved and treasured, delightful and pleasant, awesome and powerful, correct and accepted, good and beautiful is this affirmation to us forever and ever. True, the God of the universe is our King. The Rock of Jacob is the shield of our Yeshua. From generation to generation, he endures, and his name endures, and his throne is well established. His sovereignty and faithfulness endure forever. His words are living and enduring, faithful and delightful forever, and to all eternity.
Alaboteinu ve'aleinu, albaneinu ve'aldoroteinu, ve'alkoldoro sera Israel abadeja.
Amen.
Please rise for Shabbat Amidah. Tehilo leliyon baruchu meborak, Moshe uvene Yisrael lechanu shira, besincha rabba beamru kulam. Mi kamocha ba'elim nadronai, mi kamocha nedar bakodesh, nora tehilot osefele. Shira hadasha sinchu gulin lesincha tsefayam,
Adonai Yimloch Leolam Ba'el,
Sud Yisrael, Kuma Bezra Yisrael, Ufedehinu Mecha Yehuda Be'Yisrael, Goaleinu Adonai Sebaoshemo, Kedosh Yisrael, Baruch Ata Adonai, Gael Yisrael. Adonai sefatai titach, ufi yagite hilateja, baruchata Adonai, Eloheinu, Elohei Aboteinu, Elohei Abraham, Elohei Yitzhak, Elohei Yaakov. Ael Agadol Agibor Beanora, El Elion, Gome Hasadin Tobin, Bekone Hakol, Besoher Hasde Habot, Umebigo El Ibne Beinem, Leman Shemo Beaba, Melejo Shumosio Magen, Barujata Adonai, Magen Abraham. Amen. Atagi boleolan Adonai, mejayen metinata rable oshia, mashi baruja umori agesen, mejalke hayin bejeser, mejayen metin berraja min rabin, somej noflin berofe jolim, umatira surin, umekayen nemunato lishene afar, Mi hamoja balgeburot, umido melag, meleg me minu mejaye usmas miya yeshua, bene manata lejayon metin, barujata adonai, mejaye hametin.
We shall sanctify your name in this world, just as they sanctify it in heaven above. As it is written by your prophet, and one angel will call to another and say,
Nekadeses in haba olam, kesef sen hadisotom bismei marron, kakatu al yaed nevieja, bekarasel se beha mar, kadosh, 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 Adonai tsebaot, melokolares kebodom.
Then with a sound of great noise, mighty and powerful, they make heard a voice, raising themselves toward the seraphim. Those facing them say, Blessed.
Azbel korras gadola di behasak, mas min komit nasin lumat serafin, lumatam baruch yomeru, baruch kevod Adonai mim komon.
From your place, our King, you will appear and reign over us, for we await you. When will you reign in Zion? Soon in our days, forever and ever, may you dwell there. May you be exalted and sanctified within Jerusalem, your city, from generation to generation and for all eternity. May our eyes see your kingdom as it is expressed in the songs of your might, written by David, your righteous anointed.
Minkom hamalkenu tofia betinlo haleinu kimachan kimnanaknu lak mataim tinlo betzion bekaro beyameinu lolaba el tiskon tigadal betikadash betoch Yerushalayrinja Leedor Bador Ulenesa Nesahin Beineinu Tirena Tirena Malhuteja Kandabar Amur Beshireuseja Al Yei de David Mesiatzit Keja Yimloch Adonai Leolam Elohai etzion, ledor bador, aleluya. Ledor bador nagid goeleja, ulenetza nezajin, kedusha janat dis, bezin jaja elokeinu, mipinu lo yamush lo lamba el, kiel melegadol bekadoshatam, barujata adonai, jaela kadosh.
Moshe rejoined the heaps on his portion. That you calling him an faithful servant and crowned splendor, you placed on his head when he stoned before you on Mount Sinai. He broke down two stone tablets in his hand, and which inscribing the observance in the Shabbat, so this written in your Torah.
Beshamru ben Israel ta Shabbat, la azote da Shabbat drotan britolan, beinu ben Israel od gileolam, kisheche yamina shadonai, eta shamayen betaharet, Ubayon has bish bayina fas.
Our God and the God of forefathers, may you be pleased with our rest. Sanctify us with your commandments and great us or share in your Torah. Satisfy us from your goodness and gladness with your salvation and purify our heart and your service you sincerely. O Adonai, your God, we Lord and favor. Grain us at your holy Shabbat and heritage and may Israel, the sanctifiers in your name, rest on need.
Baruch ata Adonai, Mekadesh HaShabbat.
Be favorable, Adonai, your God, toward your people Israel, and they pray and restore the service on the holy and the holies of your temple. They fight offerings for Israel, and they pray it accepted with love and favor. And may the servant of your people Israel always be favorable to you. May our eyes behold your return in Zion in compassion.
Baruch ata Adonai, amachashiesinato letzion.
We gratefully thank you, for it is you who are Adonai our God and the God of our fathers. For all eternity, rock our life, share our salvation, and you from generation to generation, will share thank you and relate your praise. For our lives, we are committed to you, power and our soul that are instructed to you. For your miracles that are with us every day, and for your wonders and favor in every season, evening, morning, and afternoon, the beneficent one, for your compassion were never exhausted, and the compassion one for your kindness never ended. Always have we put our hope into you. For all this, may your name be blessed and exalted, O King, continually, forever and ever. Everything alive, we gratefully acknowledge you, Salah. And praise your name sincerely, our God, our salvation, our health, Selah.
Baruch ata Adonai, atoshim haulechana eleodon.
Our God and the God of forefathers, bless all the written verses placed in the Torah that was written by the God and Moshe, your servant, that was said by Aaron, his son, and the Kohanim, your holy people, as it is said.
Yeva rechecha Adonai beishmerecha.
And you read it, that song.
Ya era Adonai panameleja, bijuneja.
can't even read its own.
Yis Adonai panamelecha ve'ashen lecha shalom.
Can't even read its own.
Establish peace, goodness, blessings, gratefulness, kindness, and compassion upon us and upon all your people Israel. Bless us, our Father, all of us as one, with the life of your countenance. For with the life of your countenance, you have given us, Adonai, your God, the Torah, the life and love and kindness, righteousness, blessings, compassion, life and peace. And may it be good in your eyes to bless your people Israel in every season and every hour with your peace. Baruch ata Adonai, Amah HaShinato, Es lija. Baruch ata Adonai, Ambareket amo, Yisrael, Bashalom. Amen. Oseh Shalom bin Roman, Oyaseh Shalom Aleinu, Berkol Yisrael bin Ru.
Amen. May it be your will, Adonai our God, and the God of our forefathers, that the holy temple be rebuilt speedily in our days. Grant us our share in your Torah, and may we serve you there with reverence, as in days of old and in former years. Then the offering of Yehuda and Jerusalem will be pleasing to Hashem, as in days of old and in former years.
Help us to pray, Adonai, and praise you with great intent, with inspiration from the depth of our hearts, until we clap our hands during prayer with fervor, joy, and sweet desire. And as a result, Almighty God, we will gaze upon the image of Adonai. And may the verse be realized in each one of us, and he gazed upon the image of Hashem. As a result of our clapping our hands, may our prayers rise to the level of the hands that were beneath the wings of the universe. And in consequence of our prayer, may it be absorbed both into the written and into the oral Torahs, which are the hand that writes and the hand that seals. Have compassion on us, O God, and may our prayers rise unto you as a fragrant incense offering, and may it produce creative wonders in the heavenlies, in the merit of Messiah Yeshua. Amen. Thank you.
Oh, ספק שטפוני אחזק בי שלא אתבר מילים השתיקות עשה
Hallelujah. Praise your name, Hashem. Keturah, Haviv, I'd like you to pull up that song, the Stone song from Kim Walker, I think it is. We're talking on the Aliyah, and Haviva mentioned that in the chat. I think it was. Won't let the stones cry out. Won't let the stones worship in my place. We're talking about going through difficult times. And how we have to praise God in the difficult times and the good times. We're gonna worship with that in just a moment. I came across a statement in the Talmud that brought more clarity to something Yeshua said. Yeshua said that wisdom is proved right by its actions. And I've always wondered what the deeper meaning of that was. And I feel like I've learned the meaning by studying the Talmud. And that what we learned was this week was the Talmud says that the goal of wisdom is teshuvah and acts of kindness. You see, wisdom has a goal. And what the sages bring down is that some people believe that wisdom in and of itself is the goal, but it's not. Wisdom, the goal of wisdom is to achieve teshuvah, which is repentance, of course, and acts of loving kindness and chesed. So a wise person is someone who is continuously making teshuvah and is seeking ways to be one of the chassidim, a person who is loving and kind to people. And therefore, if you're not a kind person, then you lack wisdom. If you're someone who doesn't make teshuva and doesn't repent and doesn't look at yourself and say, I need to make a correction on a daily basis, then you're somebody who simply lacks wisdom. And the opposite of a wise person is a fool, which is why the scripture says a fool says in his heart, there is no God. So that's the first thing. Something I want to share with you is I told you the two quotations I learned from Avi Mishan. The first was Yeshua Tov Ke'erif Ayin. God saves in the blink of an eye. That's why the sages say, even when the sword is at your neck, you should not give up hope, because even then Hashem can save. Do you realize, I know you do, but let me just tell you, there is the story of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. And because of a false accusation made against them, they were going to be thrown into the fiery furnace. And the king said, well, you bow down to my idol, then I won't throw you into the fiery furnace. And Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego said, listen, our God is able to save us, but even if he doesn't save us, we won't bow down to your idol. So they believe God. These are righteous men. And so they were walked to the fiery furnace that Nebuchadnezzar had made seven times hotter than it had ever been that hot before. And in fact, it was so hot that when the guard opened up the door to throw them in, he was consumed. He burst into flames. It was so hot. They got closer to the furnace, and don't you know that those three men were saying, you know, Hashem, now's a good time. When they saw the door open and the man burst into flames, they said, no, surely, Hashem, now you will save us. But they threw them into the fire. And Nebuchadnezzar looked and said, did we not throw three in? But I see a fourth looking like unto the Son of Man. And when they came out, they did not even smell like smoke, the scripture says. And what we learn in the insights is that when that happened, at the very same time that happened, the dead bones, the valley of dead bones in the wilderness came to life. And what happened was is that the sages say that the Hashem in heavens, the angels came, the angel of water said, come, I will douse the fire. And God said no. Because then it will be counted as if something natural had happened. So he sent the angel of fire, who is Memtet, by the way, and said, go and make the fire not burn. And so that's why when he looked in, he saw one and like unto the Son of Man, because it was Memtet, it was Yeshua, who was there making the fire not burn. And there are times at which we walk through the fire, and you say, how did I walk through the fire and I came out? And God said, because I sent Yeshua to make sure that it wouldn't burn you, but it would achieve the goal that I sent it for. And the goal in this case was to increase those three men's faith. Don't you know that their faith was increased? And it was to change the heart of the king, because just like Pharaoh, when they came out, Nebuchadnezzar said, these men, their God is God. And he had all the lying accusers thrown into the fire and they were burned to bits. Just like Daniel, God did the same thing with Daniel. He sent an angel in the appearance of a lion. Who do you think that was? And the lions saw the giant lion And that's why they were like, yeah, we're not going to touch this guy. And the king ran over there and said, Daniel, Daniel, are you okay? He said, it is well. He said, pull him out of there. It was also a false accusation. And who falsely accused this man? These did throw them in with their wives and their children. It was a great number of people, by the way. It was several hundred people, the sages tell us. And it says the lions consumed them before their bodies could hit the ground. So therefore, Avi taught me another phrase, and I feel like I've memorized it. Not as good as the first one. I need to do better. But I believe it's memaoz bomatuk. From the hard or from the difficult comes the sweet. And it's a reference, actually, to the honey that Samson got from the carcass of the lion. Nobody wants to go through the hard. Trust me, and nobody need to ever ask. In fact, one of the reasons why Yosef got into trouble was because he asked God, God, test me like you tested Abraham and Isaac. Don't ever say that. That's one of the reasons the sages say why Joseph went through so much hardship. Now, the end result was good, but nobody wants to go through the bad. But understand this, it's from the tough, it's from the strong that the sweet comes. Memo'oz bo matoch. And so we're just going to worship God because, listen, we need this wisdom. We need this wisdom. And this wisdom is what makes us people of teshuvah and people of kindness. Lapid, Judaism is going to be known for and is known already for lots of things. It's known to be the only place you can come where we actually live like Mashiach and the apostles lived. Not pretending, not putting on a show, a facade of Judaism, but actually living Judaism. But that's not really what I want us to be known for. What I want us to be known for is the spirit of teshuva and loving kindness. And of course, that leads to joy and all kinds of other good things. But when people walk through this door, I want them to feel the Ruach HaKodesh. I want them to feel the Shekinah. I want them to feel that these people have been through some things and they've come out on the other side and they're people of wisdom. And we know that because they're full of teshuvah and loving kindness. So just close your eyes right now as we're about to launch that song. But before we do that, just close your eyes right now. If you're online right now watching, just close your eyes. Father, we accept Messiah Yeshua as our atonement. We accept him as our angel of fire, our Memtet, the one who makes the fire not burn, the one who closes the mouth of the lions, the one who rescues and sets free. The one whose blood is on the proverbial doorpost of our hearts. The one who causes your Ruach to pass over us and save us. Change us. Make us people of wisdom. Make us people of teshuva. Make us people of chesed. And Father, don't let us be people who have an outward appearance of godliness but lack the power of God. Father, cause your spirit to dwell in us. Father, we don't want the difficulty. We don't want the trials. We don't want the temptations. We don't want the challenges. But we recognize, Hashem, that it's from that dead lion's carcass that we abstract the honey. So, Father, we bless you. We ask you right now, Lord God, to help us lift up your name, to help us be true believers of Messiah Yeshua, to help us be true worshipers. And as we worship to this song this morning, Father, let our hearts cry out. We're not going to let the stones cry out. We're not going to let the birds cry out. We're not going to let the animals cry out. We're not going to let the angels cry out. Father, we're going to drown out their voices as we magnify you. And let's play this song and worship the King who rules over kings today. Hallelujah. Thank you, Hashem.
Standing with my hands held high, the valley will never take my song. Find me in the desert, holding on to you for life. The desert will never take my song. Oh, the desert will never take my song. I will praise you. Where you prophesy, still shouting of everything you've done. High up on the mountain, I was made to testify. Forever, you will have my song. Oh, forever.
Something in me has to. I won't let the stones cry out. Oh, I'm gonna praise you. Oh.
Hallelujah, hallelujah. Father, we're not going to let the stones cry out. We're going to praise you, Hashem. You're going to hear a hallelujah from us. Hallelujah, praise your name. I want you to do me a favor. God has blessed us already. When this place is so full that you can't find a seat, you can barely walk down the hallway because there's too many people and we're having issues because we don't have enough room for the children because the rooms aren't big enough. And when you go into the Hover Hall and you have a problem because you can't find a seat and you've got to go out into our new prayer garden area and sit. When parking is a challenge and you're having to park far away and walk, I want you to do me a favor. When people ask you, and maybe reporters ask you, how in the world did that happen? Here's what I want you to say. I don't want you to say it's because we had Torah. I don't want you to say it's because we had truth. And God knows I don't want you to say it's because we have a great rabbi or something like that, or we have great Zakens, or we have awesome goodbyes, or, you know, it's because of the Rebbe scene. Well, you can say it's because of the Rebbe scene. That's okay. You can say that. No, don't say that. Don't say it's because of Keturah, Haviva, or anything else, or don't say it's because we serve food. Here's what I want you to say. Here, and I mean this with my whole heart, because see, this question is going to be asked of you. Here's what I want you to say. Because when we were in the fire, there was one like unto the Son of Man with us. That's what I want you to say. It's God. That's the point. It's Hashem. That's all it is. It's Hashem. It's Hashem. It's because we believed God, and that's it. All who put their trust in him shall not be put to shame. That's it. That's the message that I want us to tell the world, because we put our whole hope in Hashem. Because remember, that's wisdom. Wisdom is teshuva and acts of loving kindness. Father, we thank you, Lord God, because you have delivered us from the fiery furnace. You have shut the mouth of the lion. You have, just like the prophet Elijah, delivered us from the Jezebel. You, Lord God, have worked miracles for us corporately and individually. Father, you have refined us to be sure. And we bless you for that, Father. And we thank you for that refining fire. Hallelujah. Can I just tell you one more thing? You got a second for one more thing? Speak, because a refining fire made me think of this. A long time ago in a galaxy far, far away, there was a Rebbe Zin who was teaching about this refining fire thing. She wrote that she asked a silversmith about it. Like, how is this done exactly? What she said was remarkable, and I never forgot it. The silversmith told her that he has like a spoon-type device, and he puts the silver in there, and he puts it over a flame. And he holds it there over the flame until all the impurities are burned up out of the silver. Obviously, it's hot. And so the Rebbe Zin asked him, well, how do you know when the silver is properly refined? And the silversmith told her, and this is what she wrote in her article, she said, the silversmith said, when I can see my reflection in the silver, I know that the impurities are gone. This is why when you're going through challenging things, press into God. Don't try to fix it, because it's not until he sees his reflection in you that the fire stops. So the best thing to do is seek him and everything else. Hashem, help me to be more like you in this circumstance. I guess we should, from here, we should just go to Oneg. No, I'm just kidding. Come on, let's bring out the Torah. Let's the Zakens come forth. No, y'all don't want to miss the message and the Torah reading and all that other stuff. Baruch Hashem. There is none like you among the gods, Adonai, and there is nothing like your works. Your kingdom is a kingdom spanning all eternities, and your dominion is throughout every generation. Adonai reigns. Adonai has reigned. Adonai shall reign for all eternity. Adonai will give might to his people. Adonai will bless his people with shalom. Father, we thank you. It says you will, not that you might, not that you could, not that you usually do, but you will bless his people with shalom. So, Father of compassion, do good with Zion according to your will. Rebuild the walls of Jerusalem, for we trust in you alone, O King God, exalted, uplifted, master of the world. Hallelujah. Please join us as the Hazan leads us in the Vehi Ben Soa.
Vehi Ben Soa Aron, Vayomer Moshe, Kuma Adonai, Bealfusu Oiveja, Beyanusu Mesaneja, Mi Paneja. Ki mitzion tetze tora, ki mitzion tetze tora, udebar Adonai mirushalayim, barushenatan tora tora, Barushenatan Torah Torah Leamo Yisrael Bigdushato.
Hine HaTorah, Hine Yeshua.
Yeshua Mashiach.
Let's continue to bless and magnify and glorify Hashem by bringing tithes and offerings to the house today. We have tzedakah boxes behind us. We have ways to contribute online. Let's come and bless Hashem this morning. Amen. Thank you, Hashem. Father, we bless you for all of your miraculous provision you make for us. We are here. We are well-fed and well-clothed and alive and just thankful, Father, for everything you've done for us. And so, therefore, it is our joy to give you the tithes and give you the offerings, to celebrate you, Hashem, and to just glorify your wondrous name and to ensure that your truth continues to spread forth. In the merit of Messiah Yeshua. Amen. Thank you, Hashem. Let's rise to our feet as we prepare to have the reading of the word of Adonai today from the Torah, the Haftarah, and the Besorah.
May he help shield and save all who take refuge in him. And now let us respond. All of you ascribe greatness to our God and give honor to the Torah. Arise, Aaron ben Ellis, Rabbi Aaron ben Ellis, Zakin Rayford ben Avraham, and Zakin Yigal ben Avraham, all Israelites, welcome to the Torah.
Amen.
Blessed is he who gave the Torah to his people Israel in his holiness. The Torah of Hashem is perfect, restoring the soul. The testimony of Hashem is trustworthy, making the simple one wise. The orders of Hashem are upright, gladdening the heart. The command of Hashem is clear, enlightening the eyes. Hashem will give might to his nation. Hashem will bless his people with shalom. The God whose way is perfect, the promise of Hashem is flawless. He is a shield for all who take refuge in him.
You who cling to Adonai, your God, you are all alive today.
You who cling to Hashem, your God, you are all alive today.
Baruch et Adonai Yamborach.
Baruch Adonai Hamborach le'olam va'ed.
Baruch Adonai Yamborach le'olam va'ed.
Baruch atah Adonai Eloheinu melech haolam. Asher bachar banu mikol amin. Benatan lanu et Torato, Baruch atah Adonai, noten haTorah. Amen.
Amen. You may be seated. We're in Parashah Vayigash this week, and today I'll be reading the first three verses of the first Aliyah Vayigash from the Torah scroll, and then the entirety of the first Aliyah in the Queen's English, Baruch Hashem. Amen. Vayigash Elil Yehuda. Vayomer bi Adonai, yedaber na avdecha, debar be azni Adonai, ve'el achar afecha, be'afadecha ki kumocha, kefaro Adonai, she'el et avdav, leomer, ha'yish lechem. Av, o av, ach, venamar el Adoni, yesh le neno, av zekan, veyada lad ziknim, veyelet ziknim, ketan, veachi va met. And the entirety of that Aliyah from Genesis chapter 44 and verses 18 through 30. When Judah approached him and said, I beg your pardon, my Lord, let not your servant say a word in my Lord's ears, and don't be angry with your servant, since you are like Pharaoh. My Lord asked his servant, saying, do you have a father or a brother? So he said to my Lord, we have a father who is old, a child born to him of his old age, and he's young. Now his brother is dead, so he is the only one of his mother's children left, and his father loves him. Then you said to your servant, bring him down to me so that I can look at him. But we said to my Lord, the boy cannot leave his father. If he were to leave his father, he would die. Then you said to your servants, unless your youngest brother comes down with you, you won't see my face again. Now when we went up to your servant, my father, we told him my Lord's words. Then our father said, go back, buy us a little grain for food. So we said, we won't go down unless we have our youngest brother with us. Then we'll go down. For we won't see the man's face unless our youngest brother is with us. Then your servant, my father, said to us, you yourselves know that my wife bore me two sons. One went out from me, so I said, he must have been torn to shreds, and I haven't seen him since. And if you also take this one away from me before me, and an accident happens to him, then you'll bring my gray hair down to the evil of Sheol. Now if I come to your servant, my father, and the boy isn't with us, since his life is bound up in his life, then he sees that the boy is no more, he will die. Amen. The blessing after the Torah reading.
Adonai, Eloheinu melech haolam, asher natan lanu Torat emet, behayon lanu ata betohenu, baruch ata Adonai, noten haTorah. Amen.
Amen.
He who blessed our forefathers, Avraham, Yitzhak, and Yaakov, may he bless Rabbi Aaron ben Ellis, because he has come up to the Torah in honor of the omnipresent, in honor of the Torah, in honor of the Shabbat. As a reward for this, may the Holy One blessed as he protect him and rescue him from every trouble and distress, from every plague and illness, and may he send blessing and success in his every endeavor. Together with all Israel, his brethren, now let us respond. Amen. Amen. Please welcome Zakin Rayford Ben Avraham.
Shabbat shalom, mishpacha.
Shabbat shalom.
The bracha, the blessing before reading the Haftorah. Baruch atah Adonai Eloheinu melech haolam, who has chosen good prophets and was pleased with their words that were uttered with truth. Baruch atah Adonai, who chooses the Torah, Moshe, his servant, Israel, his nation, and the prophets of truth and righteousness. Amen. Vayigash, Haftorah reading is Ezekiel 37, 15 through 28. The word of Adonai came to me, saying, "You son of man, take one stick and write on it for Judah, for Bnei Israel. Join with him. Then take another stick and write on it for Joseph, the stick of Ephraim, and all the house of Israel joined with him. Join them one to another for yourself. Then one, Slika, join them one to another for yourself as one stick, so they may become one in your hand. When the children of your people speak to you, saying, 'Won't you tell us what you mean by this?' say to them, 'Thus says Adonai Elohim, behold, I will take the stick of Joseph, which is in the hand of Ephraim, and the tribes of Israel joined with him, and I will put them together with the stick of Judah and make them one stick. They will be one in my hand. The sticks that you wrote on will be in your hands before their eyes.' Then say to them, 'Thus says Adonai Elohim, behold, I will take Bnei Israel from among the nations where they have gone, and I will gather them from every side and bring them into their own land. I will make them one nation in the land on the mountains of Israel, and one king will be king to them all. They will no longer be two nations, never again be divided into two kingdoms. They will never again be defiled with their idols. Their detestable things are with any of their transgressions. I will save them out of all their dwellings, in all their dwellings in which they sinned. I will purify them. Then they will be my people, and I will be their God. My servant David will be king over them. They will all have one shepherd. They will walk in my ordinances and observe my rulings and do them. They will live in the land that I gave to my servant Jacob, where your ancestors lived. They will live there, their children and their children's children, forever. and my servant David will be their prince forever. I will cut a covenant of shalom with them. It will be an everlasting covenant with them. I will give to them and multiply them. I will set up my sanctuary among them forever. My dwelling place will be over them. I will be their God, and they will be my people. Then the nations will know that I am Adonai, who sanctifies Israel, when my sanctuary is in their midst forever. Baruch Hashem. Bless your name forever, Father. Thank you, Father. Bless your name, Lord. Oh, yes, Father. Baruch atah Adonai, Eloheinu melech haolam, rock of eternities, righteous in all generations, the trustworthy God who says and does, who speaks and fulfills, all of whose words are true and righteous. Trustworthy are you, Adonai, our God, and trustworthy are your words. Not one of your words are turned back to its origin unfulfilled. For you are God, trustworthy and compassionate King. Baruch atah Adonai, the God who is trustworthy in all his words.
Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Amen.
Amen.
He who blessed our forefathers, Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, may he bless Zakin Rayford ben Abraham, because he has come up to the Torah in honor of the Omnipresent, in honor of the Torah, in honor of the Shabbat. As a reward for this, may the Holy One, blessed is he, protect him and rescue him from every trouble and distress, from every plague and illness, and may he send blessing and success in his every endeavor. Together with all Israel, his brethren, now let us respond. Amen. Amen. Please welcome our Zakin Yigal as he reads the Besorah for us this morning.
Shabbat Shalom.
Shabbat Shalom.
You just feel the anointing in this place this morning. Amen.
Feel something.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
The blessing out of Besorah. Baruch atah Adonai Eloheinu melech haolam, who is good, who does good, and who proclaims the good news of redemption through the divine Messiah, Yeshua. Baruch atah Adonai, Redeemer of Israel.
Amen.
We're reading this morning from Luke chapter 24, 30 through 48. And it happened that when he was reclining at the table with them, he took the matzah, offered a bracha, and breaking it, gave it to them. Then their eyes were opened, and they recognized him, and he disappeared from them. They said to one another, didn't our hearts burn within us when he was speaking with us on the road, while he was explaining the scriptures to us? And they got up that very hour and returned to Jerusalem. They found the 11 and others with them gathered together, saying, the Lord is risen indeed. He has appeared to Simon. Then they began telling about the events on the road and how he became recognized by them in the breaking of the matzah. While they were speaking of these things, Yeshua himself stood in their midst and said, Shalom Aleichem. But they were startled and terrified, thinking they were seeing a ghost. Then he said to them, why are you so shaken? Why does doubt arise in your hearts? Look at my hands and my feet. It is I myself. Touch me and see, for a spirit doesn't have flesh and bones as you see them have. And when he had said this, he showed them his hands and his feet. But while they were still in disbelief due to joy and wonder, he said to them, do you have anything here to eat? They gave him a piece of boiled fish, and he took it and ate it in their presence. Then he said to them, these are my words, which I spoke to you while I was still with you. Everything written concerning me in the Torah of Moses and the prophets and the Psalms must be fulfilled. Then he opened their minds to understand the scriptures, and he said to them, so it is written that the Messiah is to suffer and to raise from the dead on the third day, and that repentance for the removal of sins is to be proclaimed in the name of all nations, beginning from Jerusalem. You are witnesses of these things. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Hashem, open our minds. Our minds to understand the scriptures. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Blessing after the Besor. Baruch atah Adonai Eloheinu Melech haolam, our King, Redeemer, Savior, and Shield, who sent the divine Messiah Yeshua, the King of Israel, to ransom your beloved ones. Baruch atah Adonai, who renews his covenant in love.
Amen. Amen. He who blessed our forefathers, Abraham, Yitzhak, and Jacob, may he bless Zeke and Yigal ben Abraham, because he has come up to the Torah in honor of the Omnipresent, in honor of the Torah, in honor of the Shabbat. As a reward for this, may the Holy One, blessed is he, protect him and rescue him from every trouble and distress, from every plague and illness. From every plague and illness, and may he send blessing and success in his every endeavor. Together with all Israel, his brethren, now let us respond. Amen.
Please rise as we have the Vezot HaTorah and the returning of the Torah to the Ark. Thank you, Hashem. This is the Torah that Moshe placed before the children of Israel upon the command of Adonai through Moshe's hand.
Vezot HaTorah Asher sal Moshe lifne bene Yisrael al pi Adonai meyad Moshe.
Praise the name of Adonai, for his name alone will have been exalted. And his glory is above earth and heaven, and he will have exalted the pride of his people, causing praise for all his devout ones, for the children of Israel, his intimate people. Hallelujah. And when it rested, he would say, return, Adonai, to the myriad thousands of Israel. Arise, Adonai, to your resting place, you and the ark of your strength. Let your priests be clothed in righteousness, and your devout ones will sing joyously. For the sake of David, your servant, turn not away the face of your anointed, for I have given you a good teaching. Do not forsake my Torah. Hallelujah. And the Yetzayim, may Adonai bring us to the tree of life. May we partake of its fruit, and may its fruit become our eternal spirit.
Eschayim hi lamachasikim ba Beto mehea meushar derahea darheinoam netio netibotea shalom ashiveinu Adonai Elecha benashuva Hadesh, Hadesh yamenu Hadesh yamenu kekeden.
May salvation arise from heaven. Grace and kindness, compassion, long life, abundant sustenance, heavenly assistance, physical health, lofty vision, living and surviving offspring, offspring who will neither interrupt nor cease from the words of the Torah to this entire holy congregation, adults along with children, infants and women, may the King of the universe bless you, make your lives fruitful, increase your days, grant length to your years, May he save you and rescue you from every distress and from all serious ailments. And may the Master in heaven come to your assistance at every season and time. And let us respond, amen. B'Shem Yeshua, you may be seated. Glad everybody's here in the house and online. It's going to be an amazing next few months. Hashem, as I just really, Rebbe C and I were saying, talking about this last night at the Erev table, we just really sense that there's a real breakthrough that is happening now. I would say it's on the horizon, but I sense it's happening now. We're experiencing it right now. Father, we bless you for that. And thank you, Father, for all the supernatural wonders that you are working for us. We bless you right now, Hashem. Thank you, Father. So we're post-Hanukkah, moving forward to our acknowledgement of Tu B'Shavat and the blessing, God's fruit that he brings forth to us. And then, of course, our next major holiday coming up is Purim. And so we're looking forward to that. It's going to be lots of fun. Purim in the jungle this year. And Purim is a very special holiday. It's a super joyous holiday, but it's a very spiritually powerful holiday because it's a holiday in which we really receive the Torah anew, receive the Torah afresh. It's kind of like a higher level Shavuot. Shavuot is the giving of the Torah, but remember, we kind of blew it at Shavuot. So Purim is an opportunity for us to take the Torah in love, to say we rededicate ourselves. And, of course, Purim also is the time that celebrates the gathering in of converts, because that's what happened at Purim time. All the people saw the deliverance of God, and they came to believe. And so it's a time of giving charity. It's really, in Judaism, it's really Purim. I know that Hanukkah is like a gift-giving time, but really Purim is the time for giving gifts. Baskets of gifts, mishloach manot, we call them, giving baskets of food and so forth. Maybe that's where the Easter basket, they got that from the Easter, who knows. But giving food and things like that, blessing people with charity and tzedakah. It's a really powerful point. So, I have a down collar. Here we go. Is that ready? Hold on a second. I got a wardrobe issue. Is that good? Okay. Sorry about that. Sorry. I was wondering why I couldn't think straight. There's some kind of issue going on. We're going to dive right into our message. Today, we're going to be talking about overcoming the Satan. And we're going to be looking at Yeshua's testing in the wilderness today. We're looking at his testing in the wilderness. Remember that this is about the gospel of Moses. And so anything and everything that happens in Yeshua's ministry and in the gospel message, we have to see the pattern in the Torah. If the pattern is not there, then we have to question what's going on here, because Hashem does nothing unless he first creates a pattern for us. So we're going to be looking at this story, and we're going to be juxtaposing it to a couple of incidents in the Torah of Moses, in the law of Moses, where we see overcoming the Satan in certain instances, one of which has to do with Potiphar's wife and Joseph. We're going to take a little bit of a deeper dive into that and explore what Joseph went through, because it's not, I know sometimes we read, this is why reading the written Torah is wonderful, and we should, it's the holy word of God, and we also need the sources, because we get a much richer understanding. A lot of people think that Potiphar's wife, rather, kind of hit on Joseph, and he kind of said no thank you, and she tried a few times, and then finally she just kind of took his coat and blamed him. And it seems like, good for Joseph. He resisted the woman who was coming on to him. But It's actually much deeper than that. It was much, much, much more intense. And anyway, we're going to talk about it. We're going to look at Joseph's life. We're going to learn some lessons, not just about the gospel, of course. That's the biggest lesson. But the other lesson is, how can we overcome the Satan? How can we? Because how many of you know there's a Satan operates in your life? You better believe it. It's called the Yetzer Hara. Everybody, sadly, everybody has a little bit of the Satan in them. Some people are the Satan. But it's like that joke, you know, the man, you know, Satan appears to the man at the foot of his bed one night. He just wakes up and looks at him and rolls over and goes back to sleep. The next night, the Satan does it again. He appears before the man, looks up, goes back to sleep. The third night, he does it again, and the man starts to turn back over and go to sleep, and Satan shakes his foot. He goes, hey, I'm the Satan, and you're supposed to be scared. Like, how can you just roll over and go to sleep? He's like, I'm married to your sister. It's not my wife. I just said that's that guy's wife. Let us pray. Blessed are you, Adonai, our God, King of the universe, who has sanctified us with his commandments and has commanded us to engross ourselves in the words of Torah. Please, Adonai, our God, sweeten the words of your Torah in our mouth, in the mouth of your people, the house of Israel. May we and our offspring and the offspring of your people, the house of Israel, all of us know your name and study your Torah for its own sake. Blessed are you, Adonai, who teaches Torah to his people Israel. Amen. Glad to have you back, Mark. I hope you enjoyed you and Rosemary enjoyed your trip. Baruch Hashem. Amen. Amen. Luke chapter 4. Luke chapter 4. It says, Yeshua returned from the Jordan, the Yarden, and he was filled with the Holy Spirit. The Spirit carried him to the wilderness. Now, that's an interesting statement right there, something we tend to gloss over. But this means that it was God's will that he be tempted. You know, sometimes, ladies and gentlemen, not as I mentioned the Aliyah, sometimes we go through things and God intends us to go through that. He causes that to happen. And like I said on the Aliyah, that sometimes we can say, well, Hashem will take a bad situation and turn around for the good, but there is scriptural precedent for the fact that sometimes Hashem causes a bad situation, which he intends from its inception to be for the good. And we can't forgive that. And so in this case, the Spirit carried him to the wilderness. And it says in verse 2, the Satan tested him for 40 days. That's something else I just wanted to highlight. And that is that sometimes we read this story and we think, well, he was in the wilderness fasting for 40 days. But in actual fact, the Satan, for the entire 40 days, while he was in his weakest state, was testing him. It says, and he did not eat anything during those days. And after they had come to an end, he was hungry. So now we're learning that it was 40 days of testing, and then there was an additional time period. The additional time period, we're not sure. But there's an additional. This is after 40 days. So at his lowest point, the Satan comes and hits him with three specific tests. And the way that Yeshua overcomes the Satan is he quotes from Galatians, he quotes from Romans, and he quotes from Ephesians. From the King James, by the way. Get thee behind me, thy Satan. Right? Is that what happened? No, of course not. Miraculously, he overcomes the Satan, rebukes the Satan by utilizing a source, the law of Moses, which his followers have been told is no longer applicable today and no longer valid. Remarkably, Yeshua used that very source to defeat the Satan.
He did not use Galatians. He did not use Romans. He did not use Ephesians. He used the Torah. We're going to, not so surprisingly, we're going to learn that that is, I'm kind of giving the story away, but that's how we defeat the Satan. It's through the use of the Torah. That's how Yeshua defeated the Satan. So it says, the Satan said to him, if you are the Son of God, this is number one, speak to these stones and they will become bread. Yeshua answered him and said, see, it is written that man does not live on bread alone, but on every word that comes from the mouth of Hashem. So he's quoting here from Deuteronomy chapter 8 and verse 3. The Satan brought him up to a high mountain and showed him in a single moment all the kingdoms of the world. The Satan said to him, I will give to you this entire dominion and its glory, for it has been handed over to me, and I will give it to whomever I desire. Now, first of all, the Satan wasn't lying at this point. Everything had been given over to him. What he was lying about was giving it to him, right? Now, I want to say here, by the way, that we know that Yeshua is divine. We know that we know about we talked at length about the emanations of God. You know, there's Hashem, and then he manifests in the Shekinah, and then Memtet slash Yeshua is a manifestation of the Shekinah. So we can't quite, just as a side note here, we can't quite wrap our heads around how he can even be tempted. But what we can say is that in this case, the emanation of Hashem chose to manifest itself in a corruptible element called flesh. And just like us, see, it's really not all, it's hard for us to understand, and yet it's also fairly simple. Every one of us, I've said before, our souls were created at the same time. All of us are the same age spiritually. We're all about 6,000 years old, just shy thereof. Now, chronologically in the flesh, we're at different ages because God saw fit to cause our soul to come to this planet at different times. But when we were in Gan Eden, we were the cream of the crop. We had it going on. We were awesome. We were holy. We understood God. We understood everything. We were walking around paradise, understanding the angels. And then when our soul came into this corruptible flesh, we came up out of the ruin, and we're blithering idiots. We know nothing. We've forgotten all the Torah that the angel taught us in the womb. We come out of the birth canal, and we spend our entire life trying to get a clue. And so we can imagine if that has that profound impact on us, and so the manifestation of the Ruach HaKodesh is going to experience a similar situation. I just want to point this out to you. So this is how the Satan is able to cloud the issue. He's offering the one who has everything already, everything. You see? How the Satan does the same thing to us. Job, I'll give you everything if you just bow down to me. Why would Job do that? God has given him everything anyway. He's already a prince in the kingdom. But that's how the Satan lies to us. You're not really a prince, Job, but if you follow me, you'll be a prince. And Job's like, nah, I'm already a prince already. So he says, now if you bow down to me, then I'll give you everything. Yeshua answered him, and inexplicably he quotes from the law of Moses again. He says, depart from me, Satan, for it is written, you shall bow to Hashem your God, and you shall serve him only. That's also from Deuteronomy. He brought him to Jerusalem. He stood him on top of the corner of the temple, and he said to him, if you are the Son of God, fall down from here, for it is written, he will command his angels regarding you to protect you, and on their palm they will bear you so that your foot will not strike a stone. Of course, now the Satan is quoting from the book of Psalms, chapter 91. Listen, the Satan knows Scripture. The Satan knows the word of God. By the way, you might want to take that to account. If you happen to be somebody who's quoting scripture that isn't scripture, he knows which scripture is scripture and which ones aren't. The Satan uses, you know, we know this intuitively, but it's worth stating that the Satan will mix a lie with truth. And so there are things that he says that are truth, true-ish, but there are lies in there. That's how he ensnares people. But anyway, Yeshua, once again, don't understand it, quotes from the law of Moses in order to rebuke the Satan again. Yeshua answered and said to him, "Indeed it is said, you shall not test Hashem your God." And when the Satan had finished all his testing, he let him alone for the time being. Now notice it says for the time being. Now this was the major test of the Messiah and to overcome the Satan, but there's more that the Satan is going to tempt him with. Little digs. Don't you know little digs? Like his brother saying, if you are the Messiah, go show yourself at the feast and so forth. Those kind of little digs. Now, I want to take us back to the Torah. And we're going to be looking today, we're going to be looking at two sources, the Legends of the Jews, and then we're going to conclude it up with an excerpt from the Zohar. We're going to look at the backstory of some of these incidents because I want you to see a few elements that are going to raise our eyebrows and go, oh, that sounds familiar. First and foremost, I want you to notice something that in the Legends of the Jews, if you happen to have the Legends of the Jews, we're in the two-volume set anyways, in page 181. It's the article that it's titled The Star in the East. How many of you remember that the Magi, when Yeshua was born, they saw the star of Bethlehem, right? They began to follow the star. That's how they found him. Well, you expect that if there is going to be a supernatural birth, a birth of someone who's great, you would expect that to be a pattern. It's not necessarily a unique thing. And in fact, we find there are three specific births given in the ancient writings, and they are highlighted with unique things. And those three births are the birth of Noah, the birth of Abraham, and the birth of Moses. And with the birth of Abraham, however, it's the only one, as far as I know, that I've been able to find a source for in which there were wise men who saw a star in the east. So when Abraham was born, of course, Abraham being the first Jew, the father of our faith, the one whose mission was to turn the entire nations into followers of God. It says here, Terah had been a high official at the court of Nimrod. And he was held in great consideration by the king and his ministers. A son was born unto him who was called Abram, because the king had raised him to an exalted place. In the night of Abraham's birth, the astrologers and the wise men of Nimrod came to the house of Terah, and they ate and drank and rejoiced with him that night. When they left the house, they lifted up their eyes towards heaven to look at the stars, and they saw, and behold, a great star came from the east and ran athwart to the heavens and swallowed up five stars at the four corners. And they were all astonished at the sight, but they understood this matter, and they knew its import. And they said to another, "This only betokens that the child that has been born unto Terah this night will grow up and be fruitful and will multiply and possess all the earth, he and his children forever, and he and his seed will slay great kings and inherit their lands." It goes on to talk about the fact that they went about their business and they did not tell the king. Now, in an earlier article here, in the earlier Midrash, we learned something else about the birth of Abraham. At that time, it had been told to Nimrod that there was going to be born a male child, who was going to grow up and was going to be a threat to your throne. Now, Nimrod lived for a very long time, and it wasn't really Abraham who necessarily was a thwart to Nimrod, but Abraham would give birth to Isaac, and Isaac would give birth to Jacob and Esau. And Esau would slay Nimrod and would take the coat that had belonged to Adam, and that coat would end up in the possession of Jacob. Jacob would give it to Joseph, and the brothers would take that coat, dip it in blood, and show it to the father and say, "Tell us, is this not the coat of your son?" This is why it's written in the book of Revelation, when the Mashiach returns, he'll be wearing a vesture, a coat that had been dipped in blood. So what happened was, and these are just points I want to make to you, because I want you to show, I want to show you there's a pattern for everything. There's a pattern for the star. And then how many of you know that Herod, when he was told about a male child who was going to threaten his throne, that he decided to kill all the male children? Well, so did Nimrod. He advised all the midwives, if the women give birth to a child and the child is a son, you shall kill it immediately at her breast. If it is a daughter, you shall array both the child and the mother in fine garments, and there will be a great celebration. And it says 70,000 male children were killed. Now, Abraham's mother, it says, when her time approached, she left the city in great terror and wandered towards the desert, walking along the edge of the valley until she happened to come to a cave. She entered this refuge, and on the next day, the labor pains seized her, and she gave birth to a son, and the cave was filled with light from the child's countenance, like the splendor of the sun. And the mother became exceedingly joyful. And she took the garments which she had clothed herself and wrapped up the boy. Now, we hear that Yeshua was born in a manger. But a manger back then was a cave. And he was wrapped in swaddling cloth. So we see here that Abraham, born in a cave, a manger, wrapped in cloth and was filled with light. And, of course, Yeshua, who is the light of the world, born in a cave, a manger, wrapped in swaddling cloth. Now, why swaddling cloth? Well, a long time ago, Rebbe Sin and I were in a museum, the Jewish museum, and we read about swaddling cloth. Swaddling cloth happened to be the type of material that in antiquity they would write Torah scrolls in. And as a result of that fact, it wasn't uncommon in ancient times that they would wrap baby boys in the swaddling cloth that had been wrapped in the Torah in order to have their bris. And so this is why when you read the Gospels, you're like, oh, they wrapped him in swaddling cloth. You can't just pass over that stuff. You have to say, why did it say that? Because it's a baby. Of course you're going to wrap it in a cloth. Who wouldn't? So why does it tell us that? It tells us that because it wants us to see that this child is the Torah, which is why it's wrapped in swaddling cloth from its birth. Not just at its bris, but from its birth. You see. So we see those similarities. We also see another similarity in that Nimrod, you know, of course, the baby survives, and there's lots of stories about this in the Midrash and the Legend of the Jews. We don't have time to share. It's very fascinating to read all this of how the baby, how God supernaturally provided for the child and these kind of things. But what do we see? We have the Satan who is always trying to thwart the plan of God. Now, of course, we know on the one hand, Satan is ultimately God's puppet. He's doing this with the Satan. But at the same time, Satan is actually trying to overcome God's plan. Of course, he can't overcome God's plan. Satan is somewhat delusional. He actually thinks he can thwart God's plan. And sometimes he thinks that he is. But God is like, yeah, you think you're winning, but you're not. You see? Listen, you cannot be defeated if you keep searching for God. The Satan cannot win if you keep searching for God. And you have to do it sincerely. It has to be real. A lot of people, because listen, there was a time that I spent as a chaplain in the jail system. And fortunately, you have what became commonly known as jailhouse religion. You know, you only have faith when you're in the jail cell. And then when you get out, you lose your faith. And then you get busted again for something else. You come back and you've got faith again. Now, hopefully, you know, my attitude was I always just never gave up on people because I saw some people come and go. And I just ministered to them best I could, gave them the information I needed to give them. But I saw a lot of other officials just kind of do an eye roll when people requested religious material because they just assumed everybody had jailhouse religion. And I didn't like that attitude. I think it's an unfair attitude. We have to do our best. no matter what we think, to presume all people innocent until proven guilty. You know, it's just like I kind of shake my head, you know, in the news, they arrested a person they believed to be the murderer of those four students. And everybody's like, well, why do you think he did it? Well, that's crazy. And I'm like, wait, whoa. How do we know he's the killer? Just because they arrested him? Well, they got evidence. Maybe they do. Let's wait until we see. You know what I mean? That's how it's supposed to work, right? We're supposed to go, well, that's interesting. We'll see. Trust me. You may be looking at me right now going, really? Yeah, if you're ever in that situation, you're going to want that. It's how it's supposed to work. It's how our country's supposed to work. So anyway, the Satan is always trying to thwart the plan of God. And sometimes it looks like he's winning, but God is using that situation for your best. And listen, this is what it says here. Nimrod is trying to figure out how to dispose of Abraham. And so it says, at this time, Satan in human form. Anybody ever met Satan in human form? I have. At this time, Satan in human form appeared, clad in black silk garb. He was the man in black. And he cast himself down before the king. And Nimrod said, raise your head and state your request. Now Satan asked the king, why are you terrified and why are you all in fear on account of this little boy? I will counsel you what you should do. Open your arsenal and give weapons unto your princes, chief and governors, and unto the warriors, and send them to fetch him unto thy service, and he will be under your dominion. So I wanted to share that little excerpt with you because I wanted you to see that Satan, there's a pattern of Satan trying to thwart the plan of God. And Satan speaking to men in Yeshua's time and saying, hey, you can't let him continue. He's taking your fame away. You know, a lot of the reason they didn't like Yeshua is because they were simply jealous. They had an evil eye. They were upset that he was getting all the notoriety. The Sadducees said when he entered the city, they said, we've got to do something about this or the whole world will start following him. See, that's how the Satan uses people in our lives a lot of times. They just stir up, they're just jealous. This is why, you know, I've come to be not such a big fan of social media. I think you have to be really careful about what you put out there because you might say, hey, look, we bought a new house, or look, we got a new car, or look, we got a new TV, or I got a new dress, or I got a new shirt, or whatever. And you know, the people in their right mind will be like, hey, man, that's cool. But there's a whole lot of people out there, why do you deserve that? Well, who do you think you are? And they'll curse you. They speak curses over you. You got to be careful about all that kind of stuff. You know, and I think we share way too much about our personal life. You know, if you're excited, then send a text message with the picture of your new car to your good friends. Let them get excited about it. But don't just send it out there to the stratosphere. To the millions of people, you don't, and most of them hate your guts. They hate you just because you follow Yeshua. So it says here, and while Abraham and Isaac, let me share this. This is a story about how Satan tempted Abraham three times, specifically, to prevent him, or try to prevent him, from bringing Isaac to be sacrificed. Okay? This is the story. This is in Legends of the Jews, page 226, in the article titled The Journey to Moriah. It says, and while Abraham and Isaac were proceeding along the road, Satan came and appeared to Abraham in the figure of a very aged man. Now, pause. We are noticing here that Satan has many ways he can appear to us. Many ways he can, and just like we can be entertaining angels unaware, there's ways we can be entertaining demons unaware as well. Of course, we know that the Satan can possess somebody even for an instant. I was having a conversation with somebody a while back, and they were speaking to me, and what they were speaking to me was very negative. It was a friend, an acquaintance. Not a good friend, but an acquaintance. And I walked away from that conversation. It bothered me. And I pondered on it for a minute. And I asked Hashem, what was going on here? And I felt like Hashem spoke to me and said, that was the voice of the Satan speaking through that person. That was like an unwise, unholy counsel. A negative word you got from that. And you've got to recognize, and I'm not saying that just because it wasn't favorable to my ears. I'm saying it because it doesn't set well. You say, well, that's the voice of the enemy there. You've got to be able to recognize those things. So the Satan has the power to do it. But we're noticing here, the Satan can appear in many different fashions. Here he appears to Abraham as a very aged man. And it goes on to say he was very aged. And he looked very humble and of contrite spirit. That's what it says here. Oh, isn't that sweet? He's an aged man, humble and contrite. And he said to him, art thou silly or foolish that you would go do this thing to your own son? God gave you a son in your latter years, in your old age, and will you now go and slaughter him who did not commit any violence and who will cause the soul of your only son to perish from the earth? Do you not know and understand that this thing cannot be from the Lord? Listen. For the Lord would never do such unto evil to command him, go and slaughter your son. God would never want a human sacrifice. You hearing me? Abraham, hearing these words, knew that it was the Satan. How did he know? Discernment. You just know sometimes. And he said, the Satan endeavors to turn me away and turn me astray from the way of the Lord. And he rebuked him, and the Satan went away. So now we're learning two things, several things here. We're learning that the Satan always tries to stop God's plan. We're learning that the Satan can appear in various forms. And we're learning that now we learn that we can rebuke the Satan. There's nothing new in the New Testament. Now, I want to pause here and say that I know many of you have stories. We have stories, but Rebetzin has a story I'm going to share on her behalf about this, because we talk about, you know, manifestations, and we say, does this stuff really happen? Well, many years ago, Rebetzin was in a car accident. This is a long time ago in San Angelo, wasn't it? Waco. It was in Waco. And there was a head-on collision on a bridge. And coming up over the bridge, couldn't see the side, something happened, cars collided. And so her car was teeter-tottering on the bridge, literally teeter-tottering. And below was, I think it was a pretty big distance. If she would have fallen, she probably would have died. Railroad tracks below. And eyewitnesses said that a man drove up, took a tow truck chain, tied it to the frame of the vehicle and tied it to the pylon on the bridge, got in his truck and drove off. No one knows who it was, and they ended up putting the chain in the trunk of the car, and no one ever came to claim it. No one ever said anything about it. And had it not been for that person, the car would have slipped off the bridge. She would have been killed. Now you tell me if that was man or angel. So it says, Satan was rebuked by Abraham, but he returned. He doesn't give up. He returned and came to Isaac, and he appeared to Isaac as the figure of a young man, calmly and well-favored. See, calmly, well-favored, well-spoken. Just, I'm here for your best interest. I'm here because I care about you. Just want to, I'm just here to help you. And he said, do you not know that your silly old father brings you to be slaughtered this day for nothing? Now, my son, listen to me, for he's a silly old man. Let not your precious soul and beautiful figure be lost to the earth. Now, Isaac told these words to his father, but Abraham said to him, take heed of him. Do not listen to his words, for he is the Satan, and he is endeavoring to lead us astray from following the commandments of God. And Abraham rebuked Satan again, and Satan went from them. And seeing he did not prevail over him, he transformed himself into a large brook or river of water in the middle of the road. And Abraham and Isaac and the young men that were with him reached that place. They saw the brook very large and powerful, like the mighty waters. They entered the brook, and they tried to pass, but the further they went, the deeper the brook got. So the water reached up to their necks. And they were all terrified on account of the water. But Abraham recognized the place, and he said, there's never been water here before. And he said unto his son, I know this place on which there was no brook or water. Now surely it is a Satan who does this to us, to draw us aside this day from following the commandments of God. And Abraham rebuked the Satan, saying unto him, the Lord rebuke you, O Satan, be gone for us, for we go by the command of God. And the Satan was terrified at the voice of Abraham, and he went away, and the place instantly became dry land as it was before. And Abraham and Isaac went towards the place that God had told them. Just so happens there's three attempts by the Satan to stop the offering of Isaac, and there was three attempts by the Satan to stop the offering of Yeshua. But keep in mind, there's the rest of the story here. Satan doesn't give up. After this, Satan went and appeared to Sarah and said, do you not know that your son has been taken to sacrifice? And that caused Sarah to lose her spirit and die. The Satan is always trying to test us. Now, I want to go back and I want to look at this story of Yosef and Zuleika. Because remember, I talked about three specific tests that we heard from the Satan to Yeshua. But we have no information of what Yeshua was up against when Satan was testing him for 40 days. We don't know what the temptations were. We have no idea. But I'm going to suggest to you, if it was 40 days worth of temptations, it was probably fairly intense. And all of this is for all kinds of reasons, not the least of which is so that Yeshua can relate to us and understand what we go through. Like the sages have said, you cannot judge someone, and this is something that we all need to learn and really take to heart. We cannot judge anyone unless we have been in their place. We don't know. And this is why we have to be very careful. We have to be very careful. We have to be in their place and understand them and not judge them. Do we have to judge people sometimes? Yes, we do, unfortunately. We have to do it criminally, civilly. We have to do it in a Beit Din setting in the synagogue. Thank God it's rare. But our opportunity to do that should not be looked upon as, oh, great, I get to go judge people. No, it should be looked upon as, man, I really, you know, it's like if you ever have the opportunity to be in a jury, take that role seriously. You are there to listen to the facts. You are there to listen to see if this person can be proven beyond a reasonable doubt guilty. That is your job. Your job is not there to get caught up in the emotion and get caught up in the fanfare or listen to fanciful statements. You're there to pay attention because judging people is serious business. And I'm talking that is in a civil or in a criminal sense. And it's the same way in life. You're looking at somebody like, oh, I can't believe they did that. I'm judging them for that. Shut up. That is serious business. You have no idea. You don't know what they've been through. You don't know what they're going through. Well, what should I do, Rabbi? Close your mouth and, or how about this? Pray for them. Speak words of life to them. If you feel like they're going astray, talk to them. See if you can help them. I think that's a bad decision you're making. Here's why I feel like it's a bad decision. But you tell me why you're making it before I tell you my opinion, and then maybe I'll get some better perspective. And if after you've told me why you're doing it, I still think it's a bad move, I'll tell you why I think it's a bad move and how can I help you? Don't sit there and judge people. We don't understand how serious this is. But let's look at Joseph really quickly here. The wife of Potiphar, her name, it's a name fitting for her. Her name is Zuleika. Zuleika. Zuleika, the Satan stirred up in her an insatiable lust for Joseph. She thought it was love, but really it was just an insatiable lust for Joseph. Her feeling, it says here, was heightened by the astrological forecast that she was destined to have descendants through Joseph. What she didn't realize is that it really wasn't through her, but it was through her daughter, Asenath. Asenath was destined to become Joseph's wife, and they would have Ephraim and Manasseh, and therefore she would have descendants from Joseph, but she thought it was her. She would say to Joseph, now this is what I want you to understand, because again, just I don't have a lot of time to share this, but I want to just point out that you have Joseph as a slave. He's a captive audience. He's down and out. He's master of the house, yes, and he's treated very well. The sources say that he was being treated like a son. He was being given, you know, nice things and nice clothes, which, by the way, was part of his mistake. He wasn't perfect. Joseph is a picture of Messiah, Yeshua, but he's not divine. He's not perfect. And so Joseph, when time started going good, he got his focus a little bit off the ball, and he started to primp. Apparently, he was a very good-looking young man. And when Potiphar took favor to him and said, here's some better food, here's some better clothes, the sages say that he was treated more like a son than a slave. Well, he kind of started doing his hair, kind of, you know, fixing his face, wearing nice clothes and nice cologne. And the Satan said, here you are doing that while your father is mourning for you. Well, let me go ahead and stir up the mistress. See, sometimes we got to be careful that when things are going good in our life, we don't lose our focus. And that's hard to do, and that's why we have to wake up every morning and kind of take an evaluation. And so she started getting all, you know, worked up. She said, she would say to him, I promise that if you'll submit to me, you will rule over me and all that I have. Does this sound familiar? If you will be but give yourself to me, then you shall be unto me as if you were my lawful husband. So now you can imagine Joseph, he's a slave, and now you have this mistress who's very, very powerful and very wealthy, saying, if you just kind of submit to me, you'll have all that I have. And then I love this one. She came to him and said, that didn't really work, so she came to him and said, will you teach me some Torah? I kid you not. I'd like for you to teach me how to truly serve God. She says here, I want to forsake idol worship. So now she comes to him and she wants to be spiritual. Then that doesn't work. So then she says to him, if you fulfill my desire, I will murder my husband. I'll get rid of him. Again, she that didn't work. So then she had a dish prepared. Listen to this. She had a dish prepared for him, And over it, she had put magic spells and incantations, and she hoped that he would eat of it and that therefore he would come into her power. So now she's trying witchcraft on him. But when it says in the story, when he got the food, he saw a vision of a man with a sword in the middle of the plate, and therefore he did not eat. And when he rebuked her, she, oh, please forgive me. I don't know why I did that. I'm so sorry. It's all written right here. You can read it for yourself. I'm giving you the highlights. It looks like a 3-pager here, 4-pager actually. That didn't work. So then what happened? She decided to threaten him. She says, if you don't come and sleep with me, I will bring false accusations against you before the master. Joseph replied, said, the Lord executes judgment even for the oppressed. Well, it says here, if you don't do what I want you to do, I'll falsely accuse you and tell people you wanted to do this. Now, listen to this. Now, this is also, I'm going to read this section to you. Zelukah came to him and said, there's a whole long conversation here where she's trying to persuade him. This happens day in and day out. I'm trying to convey to you the intensity of the temptation here. And it says in the story, there were times when Joseph was at the point of giving in. And you can imagine. But God helped him. Now listen, it says here, thereupon she took Joseph into her chamber where there was an idol hung above the bed. And then she covered the face of the idol that it might not witness what she thought she was about to do with Joseph. And Joseph said, do you not understand? You cover up the eyes of your idol, but remember, the eyes of the Lord run to and fro throughout the entire earth. And Joseph continued and said, I have many reasons not to do this thing. Now listen to what Joseph says. Pay close attention. I have many reasons not to do this thing, one of which is that it is common practice he says Adam was banished from paradise on account of violating a light commandment. How much more do I fear the punishment of God were I to commit a grave sin? The Lord is in the habit, and this is what he says, the Lord is in the habit of choosing a favorite member of our family as a sacrifice unto himself. Perhaps he desires to make me a choice one, but if I do not do his will, I will make myself unfit to be a sacrifice of God. That's a remarkable statement. Joseph thinks that he might be the true Akedah, which implies that the sons of Jacob knew that one day somebody would be the Akedah, this human sacrifice that would undo the sin of Adam. That's a powerful statement. So anyway, it says in another place that Joseph was about to give in. The story talks about that she would perfume herself. She'd perfume the whole house. And he'd walk in, you know, he's a man, y'all. Come on. And she'd, you know, make these passes at him and stuff. And then he was about to give in, but then he saw the face of his father. And he said, in this, Joseph followed an example. He made a vow. He said, as the Lord lives, I will not commit this crime. He says, in this way, he followed the example of many pious men who at that moment in danger, almost succumbing to temptation and seeking to gather moral courage to control his evil instincts, he made a vow. Now, really quickly here because I'm about out of time. This goes on and on and on and on, and she's trying and trying and trying and trying and trying. And finally, she's so overcome with her desire and her frustration that she just looks down and depressed. That's what it says here in the legend. She just looks sickly, depressed. And her friends came to her and said, now this is after they had gone to the Nile festival and she tried to get him to you know, do things with her and has the coat. He ran out. So her friends came back from the Nile Festival and said, why are you so depressed and sickly looking? And it says she confessed to them what she wanted from Joseph. And it says she confessed to the women what had happened with Joseph. About, you know, y'all were gone. I pretended to be sick. I wasn't sick. As soon as y'all left, I put on all my fancy garments, perfumed myself, perfumed the whole house, rose petals everywhere, turned on some nice music. He came in from to do his work. I commanded him to stay in the house, and all this happened. And now now I have his robe. He left, and what do I do? And it says, she was not so slow to perceive the danger in which she now found herself. Perhaps he might confess to his master what she had been doing, and she considered ways and means of obviating the consequences of her folly. In other words, she realized all of a sudden, Joseph may turn me into Potiphar. So her friends advised her to accuse him of immorality before her husband, and then he would be thrown into prison. Zuleika accepted their advice, and she begged her visitors to support the charges by also lodging complaints against Joseph and saying that he had been improper with them as well. And then she went in. When her husband returned, she decided to go and be intimate with him, and in the process of that, she began to complain about Joseph in that intimate moment of seduction with her husband and demand that he do something with Joseph. And subsequently, Joseph was taken out, beaten, turned over to the jailer, and thrown to prison. I wanted you to see this because the sages talk a lot about Joseph and say he's remarkable for overcoming and not giving in to the mistress. Even though he faltered a few times, he gathered himself and didn't actually commit the offense. And we're like, right on, that's awesome. So he did the right thing, right? And then he was thrown into a dungeon. Sometimes in our life, when we do the right thing, we end up getting a seemingly worse predicament. And we might find ourselves going, wait, Lord, didn't you say I have a choice to make? If I go this way, I'll be destroyed. If I go this way, I'll survive. And yes. Well, I went this way because, I want life. Yes. I went this way and I'm in a holy hell. Like, yes. This way you would have been destroyed. This way is to the throne room. It's just you got to go down, come back up. This way you just blow up. Over here you go down and come back up. Don't ever despair, therefore, when you have a situation in which you find yourself like Joseph. But look, I went through all that and I told her, go pound sand. Why am I in prison? Well, because I have a purpose behind all this. Now, listen, really quickly, we're out of time, but I just want to say, the Zohar brings down, I don't have time to read the whole thing. The Zohar brings down in Vayeshev, 190a, that when we struggle with the Satan, and that's the Yetzer Hara, when we're struggling with the Satan, we're having those feelings, we're having those temptations to drag the Satan, it says the Yetzer Hara, but the Yetzer Hara is the Satan, to drag the Satan to the study hall. When you're having those temptations, whatever the temptation may be, whether it's to steal or do drugs or rob a bank or sexual immorality or whatever the case is, take that Yetzer Hara, which is the Satan, and say, listen, you're tempting me, so sit down and shut up and let's study Torah together. Amen. Drag it to the study hall. Because that the Satan hates to be there. It's you say, well, is that true, Rabbi? What did Yeshua do? He dragged the Satan and said, read it for me, Satan. It is written. Read it. Read it in Hebrew. It is not Greek. Stop it. Read it in Hebrew. Father, we thank you, Hashem, that because the Messiah Yeshua overcame the Satan, we can overcome the Satan as well through the power of your word. The living Messiah. Father, we bless you, B'Shem Yeshua. Amen. A couple of quick announcements. I mentioned that Purim is coming up. Purim is March 6th. We have not yet solidified the actual event schedule. We'll have the Megillah reading and so forth. But I wanted to just get everybody in the mindset to be thinking about that. It's Purim in the Jungle. That is the theme. Usually when we do thematic things, we encourage people to have costumes that relate to jungle or safari or Africa or rainforest, something like that. We'd only have three rules, and the three rules are nothing evil, scary, you know, wicked, nothing like that. We don't allow cross-dressing. There's no cross-dressing between genders. And it has to be modest. Okay, it has to be a modest costume. So that's the three rules. And, of course, we have that coming up, so I want you to be prepared for that. And a month, not it's a little bit far out, but just remember that a month after Purim is Pesach. So it's always good to start thinking about those concepts as well. We have the women's meeting and the men, the brotherhood and the sisterhood meeting is coming up on the 15th. And you have something you want to share about that, Zakin? Oh, please, come on up. I was about to say you're going to cook steak and eggs for us, but you can share that with us.
Mr. Foucault, I spoke with you last week about the men's breakfast, okay? And so put some finalizations on. We've got a sign-up sheet here. It's going to be in the back, so please sign up. Put your name, the number of guests will be with you, contact number and your email address. That will be there, so sign up here. The we're going to make sure you understood it, why we're doing the men's breakfast. Okay, and Rebbe, you were so true about seeking out, because Mishlei 25:2-3, it is the glory of God to conceal a matter and the glory of kings to search it out. As high as heaven, deep as the earth. So the earth, the hearts of kings are unreachable. The Lapid Men's Breakfast, when is it? January 15th, 10:30. Where? Here, Sar Shalom Synagogue. RSVP, firm, January 11th. Okay, sign-up sheet, like I said, is in the back, or it's here right now, but it'll be back there in the back. Okay, and why the cost of $3.37? Okay, $3.37 and a verse or two, okay, for the Torah portion, from the Torah portion of that week. Why? Because just like the verse or two of Torah, you'll need to search for it. You can quickly just pull out a credit card and pay for something, but $3.37, I don't think you're going to pay $10 for a fee on your card to pay $3.37. So go and search for the $3.37, okay? And hold on, there's also going to be a drawing, so hold on, you'll get a ticket, okay, men? You'll get a ticket. And the reason I'm looking over here in the ladies section, too, is because there's some men back here, too, so I'm eyeballing you, okay? Okay, so hold on to the ticket, because this is our first men's Torah breakfast. There will be a door prize. Now, I was going to be a secret, but I brought it here with me. So basically, the story material, the study material, make sure is going to be the find out the Torah portion of that week of January 15th, okay? And select two verses from it. Do that, men, okay? Study it, digest it, and then share it. And that's what we're going to be doing during the Nosh and Drosh during that day. Okay? So the Torah portion, and like I said, the door prize. This is the door prize. The complete Hamash, okay, with commentary from both Talmuds, the Bavli and the Jerusalem. Now, this is volume one. This is a complete five-volume set, gentlemen. Comes in a nice slip case. When I was buying these, I had to wait for each one of these to be come on because they hadn't completed the set yet in Art Scroll. Now the set is completed, and this will be the door prize, a complete five-volume set of this. So hold on to that ticket. So, and of course, if you don't want to hold on, you can give it to me, okay? So anyway, I just wanted to make sure, men, come together. We're going to study Torah together. And the purpose is you. Okay, which one is me? We know. Okay, we will discuss this when I get home. Okay. So please, gentlemen, remember, we need to come together, and we need to come together more often.
Amen.
This will be that point, okay? Ta-da.
Yasher Koach. Amen, amen, amen. All right, so we have all that going on. It's going to be a beautiful day in the neighborhood. So let's rise and invite our Chazan to come and lead us in the Aleinu. Thank you, Hashem.
Aleinu leshavel Adonakol, lakte gedula l'yoseh breshit, shelo asanu kegoya ratzot, velo shamanu kemispecho d'adamah, shelo sangel kenu kaen, begor alenu kechol amonah, banaknu korim, umistachavinu modim, lifnei melech, Malchenam lachim hakadosh baruchu shehunot shamayim beyotzezares umosha yekaro bashamayim imal ushinatuso bego beinhei meromin hu eloheinu einod En me malkenu efesulaton, kakatu betoraton, bedatayon, babashebota, elebabeja, ki Adonai hua Elohim, bashamayim imal, Be'al-Haretz, mi'itaha'einon.
Therefore, we put our hope in you, Adonai, your God, that we may soon see you mighty splendor, to remove the detestable idolatry from the hearts and false gods, will be utterly cut off, to the perfect the universe through the Almighty's sovereignty. Then, all humanity, we call upon your name, to turn all the hearts weaker toward you, all the world's inhabitants will recognize and knock that to you. Every knee should bend, every tongue should swear. Before you, Adonai, your God, they will bend every knee and count themselves down on the glory in your name. They will render homage, and they will all accept upon themselves the yoke in your kingship, that you may reign over them soon and eternally. For the kingdom is yours, and you will reign for all eternity in glory, as it is written in your Torah. Adonai Yimloch Leolam Baed, Benemar Beaya Adonai, Lemeleja al Kolajares, Bayom Jahu, Bayom Jahu, Yiye Adonai Ejad, Ushemot, Ushemot, Ushemot Ejad.
Do not fear a sudden terror of the Holocaust of wicked when it comes. Plan a conspiracy, it will be annulled. Speak your peace, it should not stand, for God is with us. Even to your seniority remain unchanged. Even to your ripe old age I shall endure. I created you, I shall bear you, I shall endure and rescue you. Amen. Shabbat shalom. Please join us for Oneg and the Haver Hall.